presidential system of government, elections into parliament and into the presidencies are independent and separate. Just as you elect presidents, you elect parliaments. And this forms the democratic foundation of the doctrine of separation of powers, because both of them are elected under different elections. They carry separate mandates and perform distinctly different functions, which are necessarily complementary at the same time. The second principle to establish is that under this system and by the powers conferred on it by the Constitution, the legislature is a powerful agenda setter because it carries a mandate, and therefore the National Assembly has autonomous constitutional powers to amend and approve budget proposals that are presented to it by the president on behalf of the executive arm of government. These are two distinct functions with autonomous but linked constitutional powers. So the question again is, how separate is the separation of powers? With this theory of separation, nonetheless, there is a nexus between both arms of government, which in Nigeria's particular instance is not well understood currently and has been the bane of National Assembly presidency conflict since 1999. It's not what is happening now. It's a perennial thing, and it has permeated our entire democratic system right from Obasanjo days. Of particular interest here is the separation of powers between the villa and the dome as far as budget is concerned. Two questions come to mind, and let's ask the question. What is the extent of legislative powers in the budget process? And secondly, how can the constitutional separation of powers between both arms of government be operated with minimum conflict for effective running of government and improved service delivery? For service delivery governance to take place, we need to diagnose this conflict. What are the places and instances where we have seen conflict between the presidency and the National Assembly on budget matters? The first is in the approval of the medium-term expenditure framework and the fiscal strategy paper, the MTF and the FSP. Usually this is a point where there is a back and forth, particularly on the revenue side, setting tax and tariff regimes, and the oil benchmark and production volumes, because these are the main elements that determine the revenue side of fiscal policy. And on the expenditure side, the limits set for capital recurrent expenditure are also determined during this phase of work. Of course, when you look at the differentials between your income and revenue, you are able to establish what is the level of deficit that the macroeconomic framework of the country can accept. So usually at this stage of the budget process, there's heated conflict about what should be, what should not be. And oftentimes, this leads to budget delay. The question of timing of budget presentation itself. We've seen many cases in the past when budgets come into National Assembly late, and the process of review and defense of budget proposals enter into the year when the budget ought to have been operational. In the case of 2018 budget, I believe it was submitted in October. It's yet to be approved now, which is about 5 to 6 months into since its submission. What does this tell us? Early submission of budget is a necessary but not sufficient condition for early passage of budget. The third issue, area of conflict, is in the estimates within the budget itself. How much money is allocated for separate activities, projects, and so on and so forth. There have been several issues of conflict in the past about disagreement between the parliament and government on the prioritization of projects. What projects should have been funded and which should not have been funded, and then you find parliament sometimes disagreeing about certain projects. Of course, the issue of constituency projects come to play at this point, whether it should be part of the budget or not. Budget defense, we have a case at hand where MDAs don't respond to calls by parliament, and that often leads to delay, making excuses and what have you. It's also a sort of conflict. Then the final area of conflict is in the passage itself. Parliament passes and the president refused to assent. We found a few cases of this in the past, and then there are threatenings of veto. These are areas where we have seen cases. There could be more areas of conflict, but these are just broad strokes of the nodal points of conflict in the budget process. Now, after 19 years, between 1999 and now, it's exactly 19 years, next year it will be 20, we've had a yearly repeat occurrences of conflict in one or more of these areas that I've enumerated, of conflict between these two important arms of government. Which means, because of the perennial nature of this conflict, there must be deeper reasons for this conflict than the presenting case of I don't agree with benchmark and so on and so forth. The conflicts, as a matter of fact, are very deep than what partisanship can resolve. That you have the party in the federal government having majority in the parliament is not guaranteeing harmonious collaboration on budget. And it is not just about the Buhari-Saraki presidencies. It has always been like that right from Obasanjo in 1999. He went through Yar'Adua and Jonathan. I think it was in the last Senate that you had a widely reduced level of conflict. But nevertheless, it always existed. So we need to understand that being in the same party that is ruling at the federal government level and at the National Assembly is not a guarantee for support and collaboration. There are quite a number of fundamentals which I'm going to examine, in my view, which determines how collaborative or antagonistic these two organs of government will be. Now, there are two fundamentals, and these fundamentals derive largely from the functional differentiation between the executive and the legislative arm of government in any presidential democracy. It's not just Nigeria. The conflict exists in America, it exists in Australia, it exists in Canada, in every presidential jurisdiction. And the first of such fundamental causes is what? Is this. Budget is an economic, political, and legal process that converts government development plans and priorities into a spending plan within the context of unlimited needs and scarce resources to satisfy them. The budget, therefore, offers an opportunity at rationalizing choice of capital and recurrent expenditures within the scale of preference drawn up and based on some developmental assumptions. And this is the exclusive responsibility of the executive arm to define objectives and make promises and then put budget as an instrument of execution. The second fundamental is that we must accept and recognize that the legislator is a key institution in government accountability mechanism, especially in the budget process, to the extent that it has to approve the budget of the executive, no matter how well intentioned, it has to approve it. And it has to oversight its implementation through the various committees of parliament. Now, these two functions are lineal and consecutive. One has to take place before the other. The executive has to think through what needs to be done before the parliament can give a stamp of approval to say, go ahead and go and deliver. But as lineal as related as they are, they have conflictual mindsets. And please underline the word mindsets. There's a conflictual mindset here of exclusivity and territoriality. The executive believes that it is his exclusive responsibility and his territory to determine the shape of the budget. And therefore, they can't live with the idea that someone else from outside the executive will have authority to tinker, as it were, with the provisions of that budget. On the other hand, the parliament, so the executive mindset says the rhetorical question, why should we prepare such a detailed budget and some legislators from somewhere will just come and turn things around as a deem fit? They can't live with that. And it's a mindset. The parliament, on its own part, responds in its own mindset by asking the question, we have the power of the purse and therefore can make changes as we deem fit. If we cannot do that, we are not rubber stamps. So the two arms of government think like this and deal with each other with this mindset. And it is this mindset, rather than the different roles that the Constitution assigns to them, that constitute the stumbling block to collaboration between the executive and the legislative arm of government in the budget process. If this is the problem, what's the way out? And that's what I'm here for. But before I come to proposals, it's always good to establish the common ground that forms the basis for it. Nigeria has experienced consecutive budget failures right from 1999 to date. Failure of provision, failure of timing, and failure of oversight. We've had budget failures. And therefore, I strongly believe the time has come to rethink the effectiveness of MTEF and FSP as a foundation for budget process. This is what we've been doing right from 1999, and we've been getting the same results. Of course, common sense teaches us that you cannot continue to do the same thing the same way every time and hope to get a different result. It's never going to happen. That is why we are saying here that the absence of a developmental plan with clear objectives, outcomes and performance indicators is currently missing in the foundation of our budgets. And I can say without any fear of contradiction here that it is yet to be established empirically how much our national budgets derive its figures from sector development plans, education, health, and so on and so forth, both at state and at the federal levels. And that's exactly the point that Bill Gates was making when he said that the execution priorities of the ERGP, the current plan, do not reflect the needs of the people, but rather prioritize physical capital over human capital. To avoid this annual pitfall, I have three proposals to conclude with. My first proposal is that the National Assembly must seek participation in the development of a multi-year plan-based budget system. A multi-year plan-based budget system. The vulnerability of our budget to predictable failure is largely due to the absence of traceable linkage between a well-articulated multi-year development plan and government budgeting system. Some of you will remember in the 7th Assembly, I moved a motion on the bankruptcy of states, the looming danger of bankruptcy of states. That was in November 2011. It was predictable from figures that in a matter of time, states will go bankrupt. And today, bankrupt they are. I also moved a motion on the need for the national planning process to be merged with the budgeting process, because budget itself is an outcome of a plan. So until the budget of Nigeria is traceable to a plan that is participatorily done and agreed upon by the parliament and the executive, budget crisis will continue to be with Nigeria. The causes of the budget conflict goes way back beyond MTEF. It is only at the point of MTEF and FSP presentation and approval that it becomes obvious that the parliament is not pleased with the spending priorities of government. The question is, there are stages of deliberations that took place before MTEF and FSP which the parliament is not involved. So what the parliament is left to do at MTEF and budget estimate presentation is to engage in a contest of will over what will be in the budget and what it will not be. And that is why, and when will enters into a place where logic ought to stay, emotions will set in and destruction must follow. Of course, the people suffer for this. Therefore, it is my submission that the National Assembly must shift its locus, the shift in locus of budget process assertiveness from contestation of annual budget figures to insistence on a solid multi-year development plan where appraisal, costing, social and economic analysis of projects and programs are done and insisted upon. That is where the power of the parliament lies. Not in the back and forth argumentation on this money should change, this money should go here, this project should be removed, this project should be added. That is not going to lead anywhere. That is what we have done for 19 years. And that is why a budget submitted in October is still pending passage in April. Because when consensus ought to have been built, it was not built. And that presumes the mindset of the executive that the budget approval of responsibility of the parliament is a fait accompli, particularly if we belong to the same party. It is when this attention shifts from argumentation on figures to prioritization of development and projects that National Assembly begins to have an empirical basis to demand that the provisions of the plan have traceable links to its medium-term revenue framework, the medium-term expenditure framework, and the actual budget provisions. Because if there is no foundational agreement on plan, this is where we are going, and this is the route we are going to use to get there, argument on money becomes emotional. It leaves the realms of logic and principles to that of I have more powers than you, which is not healthy. If this is agreed upon, then the pre-budget role of National Assembly will become more strategic in determining the developmental priorities of the executive upon which the MTEF and the FSP is based. What National Assembly and government should be debating is, should our priority be on education, on health, on road, on rail, and things like that? If there is no debate of this nature, and there is no consensus around this, what I call the development direction of government, then budget will always be in a state of coma. When this is done, the uncharted nexus in the doctrine of separation of powers becomes more navigable, and negative emotive mindsets of who are they to challenge us, which is mutual, will begin to shift to logic, to collaboration for fiscal policy effectiveness. The second proposal is legislating a comprehensive time-based budget cycle, either within the Constitution or the Fiscal Responsibility Act. Currently, it's too open-ended and subject to discretion by both the executive and the parliament. And when this kind of timetable is set, compliance to this deadline should actually become a basis to measure how effective both arms of government are doing. Let me give you some examples. Just an example, nothing sacrosanct. The debate on development direction and priorities of government should be taking place around May of every year. To say, May, we're in April now, by next month, there should be debate about what will be the priority of government for next year. This is the place of attrition. This is where engagement should happen. MTEF could be presented before June. Once you agree on developmental priorities, MTEF is now more or less a reflection of what you have agreed. Approval and harmonization, July. Appropriation bill to NAS should not be before or end of August. Passage into law, maybe October. And signing into law on or before November. Then the parliament will be able to resist for implementation, procurement, and M&E plan, which forms the basis for oversight. It is this type of engagement that can create harmonious relationship. The third and the final proposal is that there are several fiscal laws that is needing amendment, repeal, or consolidation. Because if this new arrangement of multi-year budgeting and planning will have to happen, then the Fiscal Responsibility Act in its current form is not going to be effective. We need to look at that law in particular in view of the merger of Budget Office with the National Planning Commission so that there can be a sound legal basis to do what we are doing currently. The Finance Control and Management Act of 1958, we need to be looked at to permit for specific time frame within which the presidency must submit budget to the National Assembly and the National Assembly to carry out its own obligations. And the Financial Year Act of 1980 must be amended to allow for multi-year budgeting, which will be the consequence of the plan-based budget. Let me say in conclusion that beyond the rhetoric of executive-legislative conflict on budgets, the repetitive ritual of MTEF, FSP, and annual budgets without a rigorous review of their linkage with a national development plan and project prioritization that was ab initio agreed upon must be discouraged. It is the institutionalization of a plan-based budgeting that the Constitution, I believe, intended when it gave its express powers in Section 59, 81, and 82 of the Constitution to the National Assembly. Until this shift in attention is made from argument about budget figures to the basis or lack of fit for those figures is agreed, it is very predictable that the executive legislative budget crisis will remain an annual occurrence, regardless of the system of government or whether the ruling party constitutes majority in the National Assembly or not. Remember, Alexandra Pope said, what is best administered is best, regardless of the system you run. I thank you for listening.